Good evening, everybody. I am Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager at the Seattle Public Library. And as we begin tonight, I want to take a minute to acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land. Here in Seattle, these are the traditional unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders, past, present, and future, and thank them for their stewardship of the land. Welcome to tonight's program with Angela Garbes, Claire Dederer, and Jane Wong. I have just a couple quick announcements before we get started. I want to thank our series sponsor, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation and the Seattle Times for their generous support of library programs. Thank you as well to the Seattle Public Library Foundation. Private gifts to the foundation from thousands of donors help the library provide free programs and services that touch the lives of everyone in our community. So if you donate to the Library Foundation, we're just very grateful for your support. It helps support programs like tonight's program, but it also supports our program like Books Unbanned, which makes sure that people, youth all over the country, have access to books that might not be available in their own communities. So thanks to the foundation and thanks to you for supporting them. I also wanted to mention we have assistive listening technology available on this table here with the blue tablecloth. So if you need a headset, you can either just grab it off the table or you can give me a wave and I'll bring one to you. Tonight is the first in our fall guest curator series, which invites local luminaries to curate programs at the library. This fall, curator Angela Garbes put together Midlife, Private Parts in Public. Love the title. Three programs that explore female middle age, the decades-long period of transformation that almost never gets discussed publicly. And you probably know Angela's. She is a local writer, author of Essential Labor, Mothering as Social Change, and also her book, Like a Mother, which was a finalist for the Washington State Book Award and an NPR Best Book of the Year. So I'm going to turn it over to Angela, and she will introduce tonight's program.
Thank you, Stesha, and thank you to the library. I love a public institution. So, thank you to anyone who gives to the library and just the library for being a free place where we can all come together and do things. I've known Stesha for a really long time. We were talking earlier how after a few years in Seattle, it's not like, oh, I've lived here a long time. It's also, I'm just kind of old now. But I've known Stesha for years, and it's always a pleasure to work with her. And when she invited me to curate a series, I thought about it and then I came back and I was like, I really just want to talk about female midlife, I want to get this whale researcher to come about to talk about postmenopausal orca whales and how they're highly sexual. And I want to do this book club with like Miranda July's book. And is that okay? And she was like, yeah, it's literally whatever you want. So it's really fun to be given that kind of freedom. And I knew that I wanted to talk about care, which is something very close to my heart. And as I get older, thinking about caring for people, caring in multiple directions. So one of the best parts, probably the best part of all of this, was just reaching out to people who I really admire and being like, hey, you down to clown with me about this like thing at the library? So I'm truly thrilled to have Jane Wong and Claire Dederer here with us. Jane Wong is someone whose work I have admired for years. She's the author of three books, two books of poetry, Overpour and How to Not Be Afraid of Everything, and a just absolutely beautiful memoir called Meet Me Tonight in Atlantic City. And her work has been so meaningful to me as an Asian American woman who has been told repeatedly, especially by men throughout her life, that she was just too much. I felt really I felt very seen and just also I think it's really unfair that someone who's so talented in poetry can write such beautiful prose, but yeah, that is a conversation for another time. The other thing I wanted to say is that I was fortunate enough to take, I'm working on a memoir, and I took Jane's memoir workshop this summer at the Mendocino Writers Conference, and I realized, oh, right, like the way that Jane is with her students and the environment that she creates, how that is such a profound form of care that we don't talk about as much with what educators do. In holding space for people and their complexity and their vulnerability. And when these two were talking backstage, I kind of just paired people up and were like, you kind of can do whatever you want. And it already seems like, I think that Jane brings a tremendous sense of play to things. And so I feel like she and Claire are going to do something fun and interactive. And I'm excited for that. I didn't really prepare an intro, so I'm just kind of talking about why I like these people. Claire, I always thought of as a very like fancy writer, like well known in Seattle. And when Claire invited me to be part of her launch for Monsters last year, I was like, me? Really? And when I read her book, I was like, oh, you've probably, so Claire has also written a book called Poser, as well as a book called Love and Trouble. And with Monsters, I sat down to read it, and I'm sure you guys have heard of it. It was on the cover of the New York Times Book Review, like a little flex there. But it was really marketed as a book about what do we do with the art of monstrous men, right? Like, what do we do with, like, I liked a Woody Allen movie. I like R. Kelly. How do I feel about that? And I started to read the book, and I was like, oh, this is actually not what this book is about. This book is, like, 5,000 times better than this book needs to be. It is really a way of doing accountability with yourself, and it was really, like, there was so much work on the page, and I was just like, oh, this is how you be honest with yourself, and it was really kind of a masterclass in that for me. I was like, is it hyperbolic to say that these two people, like, their work has changed my life? I don't think so, but I also feel like I'm a writer and I'm a creative person because I routinely get to have my life changed, like, on a semi-regular basis by the things that I read and the things that I consume. So endless gratitude to both of you. And I just wanted to end really quickly. I was revisiting everyone's work, and for my short introduction, which has gone on now. But, it's just, these are really, really dark times. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention that. I feel a profound amount of grief that I just know my brain is not built to handle. So there was something in Claire's book that jumped out to me then, and I'm just going to read, jumping around a little bit, but okay. The liberal believes in the constant improvement of man. Liberalism has one of its central tenets, a teleology of goodness arising towards justice. We have an idea that somehow we're getting better. This idea separates us from history. We are no longer subject to its forces. History is over there, or behind us, or beneath us. We are in a special position, its apex. From this apex, we know best. We imagine we would have been that person, the one who would have written the letter, who would have spoken out, would have hidden the Jews, would have provided the stop on the Underground Railroad. We say this to ourselves as the world literally burns, as militarized police forces murder citizens, as children are held in camps at our own borders. The belief that we know better, a moral feeling, if there ever was one, is very comfortable. This idea of the inexorable, benign teleology of justice, of liberalism, of fairness, is seductive. So deeply seductive that it clouds our thinking and our awareness about ourselves. We are the culmination of every good human thought. Liberal capitalism is, in this model, where we have arrived. It is a destination, not a blip in history's ongoing timeline. And then came, guess what? More history. It hadn't ended at all. Over the last few years, it has seemed to be rubbing its hands together and announcing that it's just getting started, or perhaps ending altogether, just not in the way we expected. Thank you for indulging me, and thank you for your brilliant words, Claire. So I did this because I thought that female middle age needed a rebrand. So thank you for coming to part one. We'll have part two and part three in November and December. And so thank you for help me welcome Jane Wong and Claire Dederer.
Thank you. Wow.
I know, that was like the best introduction.
That was really moving.
Ever, Angela.
Hi. We got together last week to talk about our assigned, kind of loosely assigned topic of care. And we had never really talked before. And we sat down at Temple Pastries.
Yep, in a CD.
Has anybody been there? It's so good.
It's so good.
It's crazily good. So we sat down to talk, and we almost immediately started talking about the problem of care and art making, and how these two things are sometimes at odds with each other and sometimes not. So,
yeah, we talked a lot about rage and desiring to make the thing, like make the art, but other things that we were caring for took us away from the thing. And yeah, we're going to have a lot of conversation about all of that. Like, what is care? What does it mean to be caring? And expectations, I think, put upon us to be caring for others, and what it means to care for ourselves and our communities and our beloveds. And it was all over a lot of gluten. So, yeah, and I think we're going to dive into conversation, but I think we'll start with a little reading, if that's okay with you all. And we'll also have some time for a little conversation with each other. So hold on to those post-it notes / index cards. And also, I have to say, I'm newly minted into mid-age.
Yeah, so we're on sort of opposite ends.
I'm like, I just turned 40. So thank you. I'm excited about this. I'm thrilled about it. I will say that when Angela was also introducing this event, I looked down to make sure I had my lapel thing, and I realized I was covered in toothpaste, like on my blazer, because I did brush my teeth like right before I came here. And I think part of maybe, you know, now being mid-age is like, oh, fuck it. Like, whatever. Like, I have toothpaste on me. Let's greed.
Right.
You know.
Yeah. So, with that.
Right. I'll read a little bit, and I'm excited to hear you read, Claire, and then we'll dive into conversation and hear from you all too. I think I want to read just a couple of sections briefly from my memoir, which, to be honest, I keep returning to this book, and I'm almost a little, I want to be nice, I want to be caring this book, but as I like now, like take time away from it since I've been writing it, I feel almost like it's no longer me. So I'm having some weird feelings about this book. But I'll read a little section. This one's called White Hair. And it kind of, the one thing that I did in this book, which was maybe a risk, was that I wrote up to the minute of what was happening in my life when I turned in my copy edits to my editor, meaning this is not a memoir that takes place way long ago in the past. I went all the way up into the present until I couldn't, which is a huge risk. I was going through like ending my engagement at the time. So this is where this section kind of lives. White hair. When I ended my engagement, my mother flew out to see me. We went over to my aunt's house in Renton near Seattle. My family fed me avocados like a baby, scooping the ripe green middles like soft serve ice cream. Pawpaw gets free groceries from the local nonprofit supporting Asian elders. That week, there were 15 avocados to eat, little dinosaur eggs piled high in a brown paper bag. Pawpaw had never seen this fruit before and gave them to us. They also gave her 10 bags of pasta. She doesn't know how to cook. So I signed up to eat miniature elbow macaroni exclusively for the next year. To say I was a mess would be to put it lightly. I gummed at the fruit, overripe, and smeared it on the roof of my mouth. Half crying, half eating, I was convinced I was fully cursed. I hadn't washed my hair in a week. The strands hung around me like tangled cords. My mother, aunt, and cousin Angela surrounded me at the kitchen counter, taking turns touching my shoulder with electric care. My mother and aunt in their 50s, Angela in her teens, and me at that point at 37. Their words swirled around me. I'm worried about you, and we are here for you. And what do you want? I told them I want to dye my hair. I recently saw a meme on Softcore Trauma's Instagram, and the meme says, traumatized urge to change your aesthetic instead of feeling your feelings. There was a cat in this meme who wore round yellow sunglasses and had a sheet mask on. That, I want that. In the bathroom, my mother sat me down and clipped my hair into four equal parts. "I don't know what you're talking about. You don't have any white hair," she told me. But then she lifted a chunk and declared with an archaeologist's glee, "Oh no, I found them." She started to paint my hair with a dark brown dye, rubbing it until my nose stung with a chemical reminder that I am indeed awake. "I'm gonna get you," she laughed, massaging the dye into my whites. My mother dyed my hair with such slow tenderness, section by section, that it calmed my entire nervous system down. I felt my wires flop over flattening soda. Somehow, I didn't know how, everything was going to be okay. When I was a child, my mother would wash my hair on Friday nights at 11:30 p.m. after closing up the restaurant. She'd lather roughly, her red nails digging into my scalp with a rage I wouldn't understand until I experienced toxic men and their chemical needs. Pure Pantene fury, the suds thrashed around my bony shoulders. As she dipped my head back under the faucet, I couldn't see a thing, just the hot sting of shampoo, my father with his smoker's cough hacking something up nearby, and her hands softening slowly along my scalp. After she rinsed me clean, she whirled a soft towel around my head. It was then that she hugged me on the bathroom floor. She often cooed to me, my bow bow, my red rabbit, my rat baby. She squeezed me so close to her breast, I felt her organs blink with mine. At my aunt's house, after I let the dye sit for an hour and washed it out, they all came over. The women, they moved in the light, inspecting my new hair. "Huh, weird," Angela said. "It didn't work." And she was right. Nothing had happened at all. The whites remained, peeking through the black like silkworms. My white hair had refused the dye. "It's a sign," my mother said, holding a white strand out like a tightrope. "Don't pull them out. Something in you is stronger than you are." And with that, she let the strands go. And I'll just read a little section from a part later, also in the realm of the engagement being called off. This is from Finding the Bloodline. "When I packed my things up to leave my ex-fiance, he tried to pressure me into buying his mattress. He accused me of damaging his property with my period stain while we were together. He demanded that I redress the damage and pay him for my blood. He demanded that I scrub the period stain out, taking before and after photographs to document. This was the same mattress he had slept on with other women while we were dating. I had shared this bed with another woman, alternating weeks or maybe days, and neither of us knew until we did. And here he was, demanding payment for literal blood. Blood he couldn't even prove was my blood. I felt disgusted, unearthed, unbalanced, sick. I had planned a future and a family with this person. How could this be, and how did I find myself here? I didn't reply. I thought back to when I had fainted with my period in high school, and how eating juk in the car immediately eased my aches, how my grip on the car door loosened with each spoonful. When I got those toxic emails from my ex about the mattress, I decided to cook. I started to chop ginger and garlic. I started to wash rice, swirling my hands in the milky water until it became clear and clearer. I turned on the heat to boil water for tomatoes, the couple small romas I had on hand. My mother taught me to quickly dip them in boiling water to make them easier to peel. My hands shook, my breath wavered, my period was on the verge of starting its flood of being alive. I wasn't hungry. I had no appetite and I wanted nothing, but I knew I had to feed myself. I had to feed the blood that has no shame, that loved even in leaking grief. I had promised my grandparents and my ancestors. I had promised them more than my survival. Fuming with fire, I ladled the tomatoes in slowly. Their skins began to split and curl like tissue paper. Even if I didn't want to, I had to start with the heart. My hands were hot with this cardinal knowledge. I was the only one the heart wanted. Mm-hmm. I'll pause there.
Beautiful. Thank you. I'm just thinking about what you read in the context of care.
Yes. Yeah, definitely. Caring for yourself, nourishing yourself. And yeah, really seriously, I got literally an invoice for that period stay. I'm also like, dude, you know I'm going to have to write about this.
Right,
it's too good and you can't make this shit up. Anyway.
I'm going to read something, I guess, slightly more, I don't know, less beautiful.
Come on, Claire.
So my book, as Angela said, is about kind of, it theoretically starts with the question, what do we do with the art of monstrous men? But it's really asking, what do we do when work we love is disrupted by knowledge we have of something that its maker did? And it follows a lot of avenues about what the audience experience is in that dynamic. And because I'm a memoirist and a recovering alcoholic and a self-interrogator, it wasn't that far in the book before I asked what I'm about to ask now. Am I a monster? I've never killed anyone. Am I a monster? I've never promulgated fascism. These are all things that men in the book have done. Am I a monster? I didn't molest a child. Am I a monster? I haven't been accused of by dozens of women of drugging and raping them. Am I a monster? I don't beat my children yet. Am I a monster? I'm not noted for my anti-Semitism. Am I a monster? I've never presided over a sex cult. Am I a monster? I did not anally rape a 13-year-old. Look at all the things, awful things I haven't done. Maybe I am not a monster. Even so, I've bumped along through life like any human, totting up at least my fair share of bad behavior. And moreover, I've done this, written a book, written another book, written essays and articles and criticism, and maybe that makes me monstrous in a very specific kind of way. The critic Walter Benjamin said, at the base of every major work of art is a pile of barbarism. I wonder, at the base of every minor work of art, is there a, you know, smaller pile of barbarism? A lump of barbarism, a skosh. There are many qualities one must possess to be a working writer or artist. Talent, brains, tenacity, wealthy parents are good. You should definitely try to have those. But first among equals when it comes to necessary ingredients is selfishness. A book is made out of small selfishnesses, the selfishness of shutting the door against your family, the selfishness of ignoring the pram in the hall. The selfishness of forgetting the real world to create a new one, the selfishness of stealing stories from real people, the selfishness of saving the best of yourself for that blank-faced anonymous paramour, the reader, the selfishness that comes from simply saying what you have to say. I have to wonder, maybe I'm not monstrous enough. I'm aware of my own failings as a writer. Indeed, I know the list to a fair thee well, and worse are the failures that I know I'm failing to know. But a little part of me has to ask, if I were more selfish, would my work be better? Should I aspire to greater selfishness? Every writer mother I know has asked herself this question. I mean, none of them says it out loud, but I can hear them thinking it. It's almost deafening. Does one identity fatally interrupt the other? Is your work making you a less good mom? That's the question you ask yourself all the time. But also, is your motherhood making you a less good writer? That question is a little more uncomfortable. As a child, I believed there were four kinds of person you could be, and I had them ranked in my head: man, boy, girl, woman. I dreaded being a woman, and maybe I was onto something. Almost all the grown-up women I knew were mothers, and even then I balked at the selflessness that motherhood seemed to call for. Motherhood seemed to me a dead end, a death of the self. It's interesting that I, like many children, was fascinated by orphans. When I was in grade school, I wrote and illustrated multiple little novels about girls with dead parents. It's generally believed that the orphan fantasy is a way of metaphorically killing off a repressive parent. But I wonder if I was up to something else, obliterating a future, becoming a mother, that was unsavory to me in the extreme. I didn't want to be that unselfish, didn't even know if I could do it. As an adult, the unselfishness of motherhood has been one of my great trials and also my great gifts. The erosion of the self that comes with motherhood has been very difficult on every meaningful level, personally and politically. And what a world of pain is contained in those cool words. But it's also been the making of me. It's taught me how to be a person who is for something other than myself. I'm not saying the childless don't learn that lesson. I'm saying that in my case, it is motherhood that taught it to me. The exigencies of motherhood are inexorable. Wow, those are some big words. You will be forced into selfishness once you become a mother. But what you will be forced into selflessness once you become a mother. But what if you also happen to be an artist? For the everyday kind of artist, not your groupie fucking rock star or what have you, the drama of selfishness gets played within a particular context, the context of the family. What the artist or writer or musician needs desperately is time, and what the family needs is time. This conflict is not necessarily solvable. Unsolvable conflicts. In her aphoristic memoir, 300 Arguments, Sarah Manguso writes, "It can be worth foregoing marriage for sex, and it can be worth foregoing sex for marriage. It can be worth foregoing parenthood for work, and it can be worth foregoing work for parenthood. Every case is orthogonal to all the others. That's the entire problem. The art family problem is or feels orthogonal, though that word makes me feel a little like I'm a project manager at Microsoft. The truth is, art making and parenthood act very efficiently as disincentives to one another, and people who say otherwise are deluded or childless or men. If you happen to read a think piece on the subject of parenthood, and I'm gonna skip this because who cares? To my mind, there's no image that better captures the joy, the luxury of solitude for the working artist than a scene from An Angel at My Table. Has anyone seen this film? Jane Campion's 1990 biopic of the New Zealand writer Janet Frame. After enduring years in a mental hospital, Frame finally finds space and time to write. In her case, it's a daybed on a shabby sleeping porch. Frame sits upright on the bed, her typewriter on her lap, typing furiously away, free and alone. Campion places her dead center in the shot. One of Campion's great gifts to film is her non-sexualized and beautifully symmetrical centering of the female figure. I mean, centering literally, not in some conceptual sense. And then Janet Frame breaks the fourth wall. She turns and gazes straight into the camera with a dazzling utmost happiness. The writer alone in a space with a door that closes against the world, that's the very picture of happiness. Jane Smiley has said that she welcomed her children into her writing room because sometimes they gave her good material, but surely this was in the nature of a radical experiment, not a minute-by-minute practice. Unfortunately, many of us do not have beautiful natures like Jane Smiley, and we really mind being interrupted. The female artists I know yearn to be more monstrous. They say in offhand, ha, ha, ha ways, "I wish I had a wife." What does that mean, really? It means you wish to abandon the tasks of nurturing in order to perform the selfish sacraments of being an artist. What if I'm not monster enough?
Oh.
I'll stop there.
I think that's a great place to start in thinking about monstrousness and also the selfishness idea attached to being a writer, and what it means to care for that selfish part of us, whatever that may mean. I don't know how we can also define, like, what is it? Do we believe it to be selfish too? Or is it just something people assume of us?
Right. I think it's the assumption is made and then the assumption is internalized. And so then one starts to feel selfish or feel monstrous. You know, I'm certainly not saying that female artists are the, you know, equivalent to one of these criminal men, but the internalization of the sense of the wrongness then makes it hard to make work. And I'm super interested in, like, I've been thinking a lot since the book came out about motherhood as a metaphor for all kinds of care, and art making as a metaphor for all kinds of selfness. Right. And so these are sort of extremes. Motherhood, the mother and the artist are like figures in a little passion play about this problem. But everybody has this problem because everybody, you know, cares for other people and has a self they need to protect somehow.
Yeah. Yeah. That protection of the self and the making of the thing, like, how do you do that? That's like the biggest like goal of mine, is like trying to figure this out, you know. Because I read those sections about my ex-fiance, I was just thinking about actually, he would sometimes call my mom, and I didn't know this until after we split up. My mom told me that he would call her and say, you know, Jane can write a book anytime she wants, but she's getting older. I think the time now is to have a baby. And she told me that later because she had said on the phone, because my mom's the biggest fan of me. She's like the central person in this book and in my life. But she also so badly wants to be a grandma. I don't know. It's like a Chinese, deeply like, you know, just like, give her a baby. And I guess she admitted to me. She said to me after I left him, she was like, I told him that, yeah, the time is now and that Jane can write books later. But then she said afterwards, she was like, well, you know, actually, you know, now if Jane feels like she needs to write a book now, that's what she'll do. And I'm proud of you for doing that, right? And my life could have completely changed in many ways if I had, you know, fell into that pressure, the social pressure of what you're supposed to accomplish, I think, at this point in life, I suppose, too. And that, you know, writing books is not one of them, per se. You know, usually when you think about it, it's like, you should have a house. Like, as if you could just, like, toss out a house and, like, catch it in your hands like a football. Or you should have a baby, or any of that. But I think for me, when I keep thinking about returning to this thing that is writing or making, because we've been talking about that too when we met up together, that's not even writing, it's making. Even making stuff that is kind of shitty, you know, we've been talking about that too, that there's also pressure because we care for so many other people in our lives, that when we write, it's supposed to be good, right? It's supposed to be worth the time away from people. And we never get the, like, I don't know, time to actually be bad at the things we're making.
Yes. And I think that, like Leslie Jameson said to me once, that she has to make her work great enough to justify the time she took away from her children to make it. And she also said that she calls reporting trips she goes on, or when she goes away to go on a writer's retreat, when she talks about it to her partner, her child, she calls it a business trip, which I think is really funny. Like, somehow that is more justifying because it's tied to, tied to making money. And I think we're both really interested in how do you protect that part of making stuff, that the only way to make something good is not to be preoccupied with that.
Right.
But I wanted to go back to something you were saying earlier about doing what you were supposed to do. And I'm really interested in this, like, pressure that one of the ways care puts pressure on us. And I get so much joy from care. I mean, I think this is like one of the incredible things about Angela's work, is it really altered my thinking about this. But I think that what I'm really noticing about care, because my kids are grown, but now there's like all the old people to take care of. So this book could be rewritten with just old people in place of the children. Like, and there was no gap in between. Not to complain. But what I notice is that when I'm taking care of people, I feel like my existence is justified. Like, I am doing what I know I'm supposed to be doing, and there's no question about it, and there's no feeling that I'm in the wrong place. You know, I'm absolutely unimpeachable. I mean, do you feel that?
I feel that so much in terms of, I think Angela was talking about teaching, you know, I think that I care so much about my students. Sometimes when they don't really have other adults that they trust in their lives, like oftentimes they can't talk to their parents, or, you know, they just kind of come to my office hours just to like talk about the biggest word, which is the future, which I'm like, I can't tell you anything actually about the future, but I can tell you, like, you know, what I see of you right now and how much you have within you to kind of create and build. But I think that there is a kind of feeling of like, like, this is what, it feels so good to like do that care work, because you know, 10 years later, they'll come to you and be like, you changed that one class, like changed my life. And I was like, did it? Like, I don't remember too much of like,
right. Like, okay.
Sometimes like my students, like they like marry each other. They like meet each other in class and like everything changes. But that is like a type of care work that it gives me so, it feels as if this is what I was like meant to do of sorts, especially since like, I don't know what to do with the fact that I may not be a mother, even though I want to be a mother. You know, it's hard to kind of reconcile all of that. But I think that the biggest thing for me is like, well, how do we hold all those truths, right? That the kind of, you know, are we able to kind of like give that care while also caring for ourselves? Mm-hmm. I think this is my biggest struggle. It's like, and I'm sure other people in the audience feel this way about like, can we have both? Can we offer care? Who's taking care of us? That's a great question.
Yeah. That's a radical question too.
It is. I'm just like, I've had friends that have had to drop off turkey sticks by my door because I wasn't feeding myself. So I'm like, well, these days, my friends call me a bat, Jane, B-A-T. Like I just like fly from one thing to the next, you know, like I can't seem to just sit there and like be still and like paint my nails, like, which I do now. But you know, there are times when it's really hard to manage all this care that you're offering to other people, including being an author and caring for the audience.
Yes.
Readers. That's like a whole nother thing too. But
well, I think when we've talked about this before, I was really struck by how much yearning we both had in the middle of this conversation about care and art making. Emerged this theme for both of us. Like I just this desire to return to some, my therapist made fun of me for using this word earlier today, pure state, some desire to return to a place where we could make something that was not concerned with other people mm-hmm. or even with its own reception. And I don't know how to say it except for to make something that's truly weird and probably bad.
Yeah.
And that I think is the moment of like, that is what self-care looks like. Mm-hmm. To me, self-care is a really abstract idea. Like I do not want to take a bath with a mask on my face. That just is like not for me. But I think I do want to figure out, you know, how to make the weirdest and most challenging to me art possible. And, you know, to that we, you know, that's why we are happy to be around poets, because they are in touch with the necessity of doing that, mm-hmm. as opposed to somebody who's come from journalism. That can be a harder thing to access. But so we were talking about this, and we know, I said, well, the one thing I started trying to write and trying to get back to something that would make me feel excited and would be weird and would be what I know is self-care for me, which is to make something that is just for me and that somehow is really connected to the core, almost like the little kid core of me. I don't, and I said, I just didn't know what to do and I couldn't make it happen. And I was just like, Jane, what I just started doing was drawing pictures. And like, I'm a terrible artist. And I started making pictures like a lot of the day, every day. And she was sort of bursting in her seat and said, I started making ceramics.
It's true.
So the self-care that we've discovered has to do with having a margin for being terrible at something, I think, which is really, was really a surprise to me.
Yeah, right. That it doesn't feel like, because when we're writing, right, to kind of like make a book or do something of that sort, it feels different because it's like, is this even for yourself?
Yeah.
Right. It is, but it's also for readers and it's for like whoever's, you know, like ends up touching this thing. Whereas like, if you just make something for yourself, no one ever gets to see it. That's like yours. That's like going back to childhood, a kind of like playful selfishness that I like miss, right? That this thing could be gone and disappear. And I love that. I don't know if people can see your drawings.
I think they're too small.
They're so good though.
They're not good. I could even pass. I mean, you could see them because they're really, has anybody ever done any Linda Berry classes? That's what I pulled them from was. So I just started making these little stick figure drawings over the summer on index cards.
on the back of which are notes for like some very serious book I was planning to write. And instead I have like me as a mouse dancing around. And like, now here's my character is my person, me, my what's it called when you're like...
Your alter ego?
My alter ego is a devil and she's furious or she's getting really drunk in one. And I started making them as this actually really like urgent form of self-care. And it happened to be that there were a lot of young people living in my house over the summer because my kids were there and their friends were living there. And it was like a very open house. And all the kids, they're like in their 20s, and they all started drawing. And I just have this massive stack of these terrible, terrible, beautiful drawings that are just everybody made and they're all mixed up. And I don't even really know who made which one, like who's this crab? And I think that it's both, like I think there's two things happening in this little stack. And one is the making of something that gives me room to not be good at it. And the kind of really this idea that really woke me up that being bad at something is what I need as an artist. But there's also, you know, so much of my book is about genius and the problem with genius, the problem with our idea of genius and the things we vest genius with and who gets to be a genius, like racially, you know, in terms of gender, all that stuff. And these, like having people make stuff together until you can't see what belongs to whom is like a strike against genius in a way that feels really self-caring to me. It's not collaborative quite. It's more like what Amy Fusselman calls a game of telephone. Like you're passing this thing around and who does the idea belong to? So anyway, that and you can show and tell your little thing.
Oh my God, show and tell. I mean, I think a lot of also, because we're still talking about midlife, but also like we've talked about this earlier too, but this idea of like being mid-career, that also seems strange. I feel like I'm constantly a turtle, like emerging.
Yeah.
Like an emerging writer, just like still emerging. But then somebody's just like, well, you have 3 books, you're mid-career. And I'm like, what? How did I end up here? But there's a lot of pressure, I think, like once you have, you know, a few books to be, oh, the next one has to be even better. And I'm like, oh, I think that's as good as I can get for right now. So I actually turned towards ceramics. I should have brought my first pot, actually. That would have been better because, like, now I can't help but, like, try to make
things. I mean, that is quite good.
Like, nice. But this is a persimmon. I don't know if anyone's watched that show about, like, pottery, great pottery throwdown or something, but the weight, when you hold the weight of something, ceramics in your hand, you're like, it's not that heavy. It's a good weight. But I should have brought my first bowl, which is like literally a boulder. Like it's so heavy. It took me 6 months to center, to learn how to center on a wheel. And I was covered in clay. It's messy. It can blow up in the kiln. There's so much failure in ceramics that I was not interested in being quote unquote good at it, or I was like playing, right? So I think in some weird way, I needed to do ceramics in order to even get back into writing because I think that's what it is. And we both are kind of, you know, working on very new things, but with this kind of like little like, oh, is this gonna really be a thing? But I think we're both allowing ourselves to not have that, or just like try to lessen the pressure of it being this, I don't know.
Well, and what I find, and I don't know if other people have this experience with their own work, whether it's creative work or other work, but when, you know, I am making something new and I'm trying something new, and I find myself quickly returning to care as a way to not do my work.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
And, you know, my partner's mother is really struggling right now, and it's always valuable to go over and sit with her while she, you know, has a problem with something or other because her hands don't, you know, I can always be a help there, and she's always happy I'm there, and it's always a great way to not try to figure out what it's like to write a novel, you know, like it's super efficient.
Yeah.
And I think that it's care has come to have like, there's moments when you have to do care and it's non-optional, right? And there's moments when you have to do care because you will hate the person that you will be if you don't do it. And I feel like that's a lot of midlife, is there's a lot of kind of It might be a little more optional, but if you looked back in 10 years, you would be really glad you did the thing. But I also feel like it's almost like the pressure to do the care rather than me growing out of it or getting some of that good midlife steez of just fuck it. Like, it's almost like it's like building up in me. Like, what are those cakes, those Gullah Island cakes that are really densely packed? Like, it's all like the drive to care is no longer even volitional in a way. Mm-hmm. It's now something that I just automatically turn to, almost like perhaps some of us who have struggled with addiction, almost like it's a process addiction, right? Like, oh, I'm uncomfortable. Now I'm going to go do this care. Mm-hmm. And that is not the kind of care I want to give. Mm-hmm. And it really leaves me very little room to do this labor, this what could be joyous labor if I allowed myself to take the time of like doing shitty work. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, and I can't, I just am like, I'm having all these insights about how I use care, mm-hmm. As a way to get around something that's challenging me.
Oh, yeah. That, and what does it mean to kind of reorient that care into something that feeds into the making too?
Yes.
Yes.
Which feels really, I don't know. I mean, you're a poet, so you're used to it, but it feels quite scary to me.
Oh, yeah. I'm scared all the time about all of that. I don't have answers. I mean, I don't know the future, even though people keep asking me about the future and the past, but yeah, I think that even just having discussions, like at least we're talking about it and trying to figure out like how to make this happen. But it's still going to be a struggle between deciding between like how much time are you going to invest into the making of something, even if the making can be completely like it doesn't amount to anything, right?
I feel like we would have the most like annoyingly Yoda-ish like writing workshop. Like, you want to write, here are my drawings,
and yeah, right, write,
here is my persimmon,
yeah, exactly,
and then, like,
now go. exactly.
But I do think there's this energy around doing this sort of crappy thing that is truly surprising and shocking.
Oh yeah, exactly. And that's kind of like where I want to be, I think, in that kind of going back to childhood, like just being not worried about what you're making, but the fact that your hands are moving and touching something to make it, including a marker or mud or whatever it is, you know?
Yeah. It's super interesting that the image of childhood keeps coming up because that is a time when we were cared for.
Also true, exactly.
And I think when we started talking about, when I started thinking about care and we started talking about it, and certainly in the thinking I've done in the years since Monsters came out, I think more and more, you know, the problem is a problem of collectivity, right? The problem, we were talking about how care is so associated with rage. And the reason for that is because in some ways we are powerless to give up our care because there's no collective, I mean, there's some that we build ourselves and we work to build ourselves, but this idea of the joyous collective that comes together to help take care of each other, like if that existed, what then does it look like to go throw your pot or make your shitty drawing or try to write a chapter of some weird book?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Like that, the problem is the woman sitting alone in the house balancing the, oh, I have to take care of the kid, and oh, I have to make the work. The problem is the alone, mm-hmm. right? It's like, why is this idea of care not more expansive, is not more celebrated, is not more rewarded, all of these things.
Exactly. Like that in itself is like that desire and that hope for that expansiveness, that collectivity. And I'm thinking about mutual aid, of course, that comes to mind too. I'm mostly just curious, also looking at time. I want to make sure we also have time for you all.
Oh my God.
I know. We could just like curl up in a hole and just like, you know, care for each other.
Right.
In this hole. We have a little time for a Q&A, but I think we want to kind of kick it off by doing a little like mini writing, I suppose. If you have, I think all a little post-it or like an index card, and a pencil perhaps, and this will be pretty quick. But maybe if you want to just take a minute and just write down a word that comes to mind when you think about the word care, we were talking with Angela earlier. Angela asked a great question, which is you can also write down who has taken care of you and who you care for, who you take care of, right? So you can, again, write down just a word that comes to mind when you think of the word. Whoop.
Or you can draw a picture of yourself as a mouse.
Yes, you can also doodle care as well. But we'll just take a minute if you just want to write down just a word that comes to mind when you think about care, or who cares for you, or who you care for, or drawing. Many options. You can do all three.
Throw a pot.
You can't throw a pot right now. You can only draw or write.
Draw a pot.
I guess I should do it too.
I've got all these terrible drawings.
I know that's pretty fast, but I'm gonna just take another moment just to add another word or drawing. And maybe just for a minute, if you are willing to, maybe with the person next to you, if you wanna share what you wrote or drew, we'll just take a minute, say hi, meet each other.
What did you write?
I drew a bunch of soap. All right. Mike, hold on.
There we can.
All right, we're gonna gather you all back.
I love it.
Thank you so much for sharing with each other. I think there's also some mics that will go around in case you want to share. But I would love, I'm such a teacher right now, it's so annoying. I would love it if a few people might want to share what they wrote, or with your, this is important, with your fellow writer's permission, if you want to nominate someone, share, but they have to give you the permission. I always think it's nice because it's like, oh, I really loved what you did. It's like, I think that's a moment of care, actually. It's really like you wrote something really meaningful and thoughtful, but with permission. So does anybody want to share theirs, or with permission, somebody wants to nominate someone? to share. We'll have a few of these. Oh, and there's a mic coming around. Yay for being the first one.
Okay. Hi. My name's Mary, everyone. Hello. So one thing that we had talked about for who cares for you, because we were both like, yeah, people around us, blah, 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 we care for them, they care for us. And that resonated, though, was nature and the earth and how much she cares for us.
That's beautiful. Yes, thank I you. Love that nature environment. That's beautiful. A few more.
I mean, it's hard to beat nature.
I'll share mine.
Yeah,
if that's okay. So I have a chronic illness and a fragrance sensitivity, and I went to a friend's house for dinner with my partner. And they had scented candles lit, and we walked in. He didn't even need to turn to me or ask. He just went over to them and said, hey, can we just take these out and blow them out and get rid of them? And they were like, oh, of course, because he knew that it would be a problem for me. And he also knew that I would be too uncomfortable asking them to do that. And he just did it. And like I was telling my colleague, Samsia here, the thing that felt so cared for, I felt so cared for because I didn't have to ask and he knew that it was something I needed, right? And so that was just a beautiful moment. Yeah.
That too. That's great. A few more?
Yeah.
Oh, no, we should get a mic. We should get a mic.
I just wrote the word stopping for how I care for myself, and sometimes it feels like it needs to be more or I have to do something specific, but I usually find if I just stop that's it, it's enough.
I love that. Yeah, stopping, yeah, to focus on the self. Yeah, maybe one more. Yeah, I know.
I just sat with the word care, and my first instinct was bland, not very deep. Like, it doesn't resonate with me at all. I really want to connect. I want to love. I want to be nurtured. I want to be intimately seen, unconditionally accepted, nourished, and cared kind of just didn't really resonate with me at all, if that makes sense.
Mm. Yeah. I love that, to kind of almost like that care is maybe too surface level to kind of really dig into what actually is underneath it, which is like the earth, I guess, of nourishment and love. Yeah.
And maybe comes freighted with those shoulds that we were talking about earlier.
Exactly, the shoulds, absolutely. Huh. Maybe any more, one more?
Drawing.
I love that. That is so, yeah, I love that. So tender. We have some time for a little bit of time for Q&A. If we have a few questions from anyone who wants to ask them.
Yeah, we're tipping over, but we want to leave a little time for you guys to share thoughts or.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think one of the things I was thinking about while you were both speaking is I'm not a parent, and so the way I experience care in my life is towards people where care is mutual, mm-hmm. or where care was first given. Mm-hmm. And I'm just really curious, like maybe to hear a little bit more, like I'm curious if the textures of those care feel different when you're caring for like a child who, you know, they haven't done anything for you. and they need you in a way that, you know, parents don't usually get to till later in life, and partners and other folks. Yeah. That's not how things start.
I think that the non, like, they don't care for you, but also it is totally non-optional. You cannot bag out. I mean, I guess people do, but I didn't. And I think that combination of sort of not theoretically getting anything back and not being able to opt out was really good for a person who's like up her own ass a lot of the time. And I think that it was, there's ways that, there's a lot of faith, right? You're not having a faith that they'll take care of you later, but in some really deep human way, you kind of are, right? I'm taking care of a lot of old people right now who took care of me or my partner. And so there is this really deep, like, animal faith that they're gonna then take care of you. Mm-hmm. But you just don't get it right away. Mm-hmm. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I think that this makes me think of two things. The first of which is my mother became a mother, had me when she was very young. She was 20, and she was married to a stranger at 19, so arranged marriage. And I'll be blunt, like, she was not, she didn't want to have us per se. Mm-hmm. She didn't want to be a mother at that age. She was still a child in many ways, you know? And I think that one thing I remember, she didn't really, she was not interested in me until she was probably 35. And so I was by then a 15-year-old. And I had spent most of my childhood kind of being cared for by my grandparents. And it's like one day she woke up and was like, I'm into being a mom. Huh. And started to hug me and kind of kiss me and say, I love you. And I'm like, what? Ah, this is so uncomfortable. But there's something about my memories of her when I was very little. Like, she used to pine over, like, really nice coats at Burlington Coat Factory. And we were, you know, I grew up in a strip mall, low income. And sometimes we didn't have tons of, like, you know, I didn't have the best things, but she wanted that coat. And so it was so selfish of her, right? To be like, I want that coat. I don't need to spend it on my kids and their, like, school supplies. And that taught me a lot. I'm proud of my mom for being like, you know what? Fuck that. Like, I don't need to get them brand new markers, or, like, she doesn't need a new backpack. I need that coat. And so I wrote this poem called I Put On My Fur Coat, and it's in her voice and just, like, the kind of, yeah, this is mine. This is for me. And I actually am grateful for her not kind of caring so much about her little kid, you know? I learned a lot from that. And second, yeah, there's a lot of mutual care with friendships. And I feel like that's so back and forth for me. And I think that that's, you know, that's what I wrote on my post-it note, was like friends. And I did concentric circles, that as I age, I have more and more friend circles, like friend communities, and the vastness of them. And the fact that they all kind of start, you see your friends intermingle with each other at one big event, it's incredible. Cause yeah. You're just like, I've made this, like, I'm like some, like, God or something, but I'm just like, they care about me. They love me. They nourish me. And vice versa. They're also there because, like, I'm there, right? So it's, like, very mutual. And so that kind of platonic love is so powerful. And I think that to me has been the central core of, like, my both survival and thriving over the years. Like, they have literally taken me physically out of violent situations, and I would not be there here without them. And so that is a deeply mutual type of love. And so, you know, we could talk a whole nother hour about friendship, but thank you. That's a great question, you know. Do we have time for more, too?
Maybe we'll do one more.
One more? Yeah.
Hello, good evening. Earlier, I heard both of you speak about some sort of guilt or being torn, the juxtaposition between the art, family, and care, right? Have you thought about these moments of making bad art, unproductive art, as a form of self-care? Because I think there are a number of people who have hobbies like cooking or gardening where they can make a kitchen sink dinner or pull weeds, and that's therapeutic in a hobby of theirs. Whereas I find, I think writers are caught in this world where it takes so much energy to precisely express your vision and put it on a page for an audience that you should give yourself more credit in that. It's not making bad art, but perhaps it's just the permission to care for your creative self in a way that is less precise and that has a margin of error or allows for error.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I feel like you just said it for us.
Yeah.
Exactly. Thank you. I think there was something so alive about this idea of the bad work that would be this form of self-care, that would be this way of having expression without product, right?
Yeah, right.
Which feels great. And I think that there's so many ways in which things that we love to do become professionalized or, you know, sort of, oh, well, if you do that, then you have to like have an Etsy shop or you have to, and it's just like, just do the thing. Just for the joy of it.
Yeah, just do the thing for the joy of it. The one thing I've done with some of my friends, we have this I think it's been 10 years actually. Turns out Gmail, I think, kicks you off after 100 email threads or something, or it gets really slow and you can't send that email. But it's a thread that we call cut and paste, where it's like a little club where it's like my friends, we literally will just cut and paste the things we've written, and they're not like finished poems. They're just like, oh, I wrote this today. And so it became like this space where I felt like I like could just write beyond publication, beyond all of that kind of obsessiveness I have over revision. It was just like, I wrote this today, I literally cut and pasted it, threw it into a Gmail, and then look back. And the beauty of that is that you open up your email and then you get a cut and paste from a friend, and you knew that they were just writing something just to write something. And it wasn't, whether or not this is becomes, it shows up in a book, or we don't know. I've written so much stuff I've forgotten I've written, and cut and paste is now an archive of some pretty bad poems. And that's great. It's fun. It's nice to know that I have something there that feels low stakes. Because sometimes writing feels like such high stakes, like, oh God, like, are people going to like this book? Like, versus just writing like for self-care and for joy and for, you know, I sometimes will give myself challenges like, oh, can I like write a poem with like Pocky in it, like, or Hello Kitty in it? And that's not something I would normally do as a poet. It's not my, I don't usually do that, but I was like, you know what? Yeah, why not? I should do it. And so I'll do that and cut and paste. And sometimes I love it. I'm like, it was pretty good. But some days I'm like, this is bad. And it just lives in cut and paste. So yeah, I think so. And I think having actual, parameters around the badness or like the low stakesness helps, because if you know other people are doing it, it does help. So your drawings, the fact that other people were drawing with you, I think adds to the feeling of like, oh, this is just to make. And it feels good, and it will lead to something potentially else, but it doesn't matter if it does or doesn't.
Well, I'm not that I have to conclude on theme, but I will say, as you were talking, I was thinking that that is just so much, such a corny phrasing, but a gift of midlife. Because 20 years ago, the idea that I would like do my writing in like my flowered notebook, and I would like, you know, use a pen and write down about my characters, and like it would be really unprofessional, like that would freak me out. And now, you know, at my advanced age, I'm like, oh, I know that this is like where the good shit is. And I think that that is something that has to do with midlife, that I can let myself off that hook of professionalism or perfection or having to turn everything into something.
Yeah, I love that. Yeah. I mean, I still got this toothpaste on me.
Yeah.
So,
there you go.
Yeah. Wow. Thank you, Claire.
Thank you, Jane.
Thank you all for being here. Thank you, Angela. Thank you, Stefa.
Thank you.
Thank-
Thank you. Thank you, Angela, for curating an amazing first event. Thank you, Jane and Claire. Let's give them one more whoop and round of applause.